Flagship Wrestling, a night in which for the first time ever, FCW will present its Super 8 match. Byron Saxton alongside Wade Penn. It is top reaction.
This is the Pro Wrestling Reflection Podcast with your host, the Professor Chalbello Veracruz. Mr. Wonderful, Tommy Wonder.
And I will take the powers of those that have no fear.
And the prodigal one, JB.
The queen, yeah. The queen of the crop.
Now it's time to go back in time in the time machine.
The American dream, back to your
home. Two. Sweet. The living legend.
Austin 316 says I just whipped your ass.
But be the man. You gotta beat the man. Woo!
Look at this. He's on the floor. I don't believe it.
What is going on there, Reflectionites? What is going on there to the Magnificent 7, the Elite 8, the Naughty 9, the Terrific 10, the Essential 11? You know, we had to take a little break. It's not like, you know, if you look at the date on the calendar, it was Thanksgiving holiday week. You know, you expect the Reflection to be on during Thanksgiving holiday week? No, because we hungry as a mother trucker, man. We wanted to eat our turkeys, our sweet potatoes, our pumpkin pies, our stuffings, our mashed potatoes, macaroni salads. I'm already getting hungry right now saying what I'm saying right now. So, you know, if you got to play for the professor, DM me, slide in the DMs. I want to play the food. Yes, TW, I want food only. I don't want nothing else. Nothing else but food.
Eddie, candy rain.
Candy rain? No, candy yams. That's what I want. But anyway, neither here nor there. But shout outs to all the Reflectionites. You know, happy belated Thanksgiving, all that. To the TN Couponers, to the Don of Destructions, to the Phillips Got Wood, to the, you know, 8-Track Blacks, to the John McCugans, to the Phil Schmicknicks. You know who you are. To the little creme de la creme of the YouTube people that kind of like, you know, fester in here and there, who listen, who sees us looking oh so glorious on the video streams. We say happy belated Thanksgiving. But anyway, this is your friendly neighborhood Professor Chabeva Cruz welcoming you to another episodic episode of the PWR Podcast here at the PWS Networks at podbeam.com and also at the PWC Networks at podbeam.com. Shout outs to Jimmy T. Shout outs to Chris Hambones. Shout outs to Jeff Lipman, Steve Pena, and the crew at the PWC, the Pro Wrestling Coalition Network. But, you know, I don't do this alone. I can't do this alone. I can do this alone. I can do this in my sleep, but I need somebody to feed off of. I need some feedback. I need a differing opinion. And of course, I got the best guy in the business to feed back off from, to feed off from, to give a different opinion, or even to give the same opinion and expound on it. He is your friend and mine, the conservative liberal, the liberal conservative, the man with the iron stomach, from the Dumb Dumb Duo and the Idiot, Mr. Wonderful, Tommy Strong, aka the Tommy Wonder. Again, happy belated Thanksgiving to you.
Happy Turkey Day.
And before you go on your spiels about how successful the Dumb Dumb Duo and an Idiot was with your Detroit Red Wing star, you can give a little bit of a tidbits of what happened, you know, any pros and cons, any like flips and dips or whatever. I know you ate it. You didn't throw up. It was so successful. Everybody was going crazy over that. But anyway, I just want to because this episode, I dedicated this to you. This is why I'm so thankful that you have been my ride or die buddy here on the PWR podcast. You have been crying. You have been bitching and moaning about, you know, my NXT, it's gone. What happened to my NXT? It's turned into this, like, effeminate NXT 2.0. The colors, they suck and all this stuff. I thought of you when I did this episode, and before Tommy Wonder goes on to spiel his diatribe of everything that happened for the past week, this episode, this episodic episode, we are going back. Now, in the T-Bolt's throwback formula, I always say 10 years and above is considered a throwback. So this happened in November of 2009. So it is in the cusp of a throwback. We are doing FCW, aka Florida Championship Wrestling. We are doing the developmental territories of the WWE. We're going to talk about that in a couple of minutes. But TW, what happened to your NXT? I know we'll talk about this in a little bit, but what happened to your NXT? Your NXT is gone. So I wanted to give you a little bit of a present. I wanted to give you a little bit of a, you know, the stuffing, the cranberries and the big turkey stuffing leftovers of FCW. Oh, he took off the glasses, Reflection Night. This is serious business.
I have not watched NXT in about 2 or 3 weeks. So much so that I had to ask you if it was old versus new blood for War Games, and it is. And I will say this. A lot of people are like, well, I think you were the one that said those War Games has no war in it, and I disagree. What they did here, and it had to be different because you don't have factions. They released them all. So
you don't have the MVPs, which is the Undisputed Era. That's what you don't have.
With the exception of Pete Dunne and who's the other guy on that?
Gargano.
No. Gargano and Carmelo had heat.
Mm-hmm.
Bronson, whatever the hell his name is, and Ciampa had heat. Breaker. Eli Drake and that Australian dude in the basketball shorts have heat. It's that fourth guy and Pete Dunne don't really have anything. So you almost need to put O'Reilly in there and Pete Dunne, but the problem is they're both veterans. They're not, you know, you got to throw a new guy in there. And for all I know, he does have heat with a new guy. I haven't watched it, but I actually like that they're doing it because what they're obviously going to do, Gargano and Ciampa are faces, Dunne and LA Knight are heels. The other team, Carmelo's a heel, Bron's a tweener, that Graham Nash or whatever the hell his name is, he's a face. So you're going to have fighting amongst them. So at some point, you're going to have two guys on the same team in the cage against one guy on the other team. So you could actually, look at them booking this in my head as we talk about it. You could actually do the coin toss where the babyface has the advantage, the babyface, you know, because they're heels and faces. Mm-hmm. The team with Gargano, let's say. But then they fight each other, so the advantage is lost because it's heel-face on both sides. So it actually puts a new dynamic to it. It almost feels like Elimination Chamber, but you're a team.
Okay.
And that's what they maybe should have done, was made it War Games, where each guy can get eliminated Survivor Series style. Like, not by your own teammate, but by, you know, instead of one guy loses and it's over, all four have to be eliminated, because then you can have Eli or Pete Dunne do something to Ciampa to make them lose, and then that starts a program with them when they leave there. So, but
well, I don't keep the train of thought. You know, everybody, I think for myself, let's not talk about NXT. I mean, even for War Games, I think everybody wanted War Games to be part of Survivor Series. This would have been the ultimate, you know, match of survival if they did it right. And WWE has never did it right. They gave it to NXT.
At this point, NXT. Oh, you meant before they gave it to NXT,
right? That's what I'm just saying. Before NXT was a thing, the Survivor, you know, War Games should have been with, you know, War Games should have been with Survivor Series. That's just
should have been with WWE.
But again,
you could have made Elimination Chamber War Games, like whatever. It's a different
they
case,
did,
but it's still
that one year. Yeah, they did that one year, the first year. But neither here nor there. But
here's the deal. Okay. Just to put a pin in it, because we go back into the time machine to go pre NXT to FCW. December 5th, tonight, if you're listening to this on the day it drops, is NXT 2.0, I still hate saying that. It's their sink or swim time, because if I watch it and I'm entertained, the girls' version, the guys' version, I don't even know what other matches are on it, I will keep watching it or start watching it again or just be done for good. And this past week's episode, I literally thought, I'm like, okay, the writing's on the wall. O'Reilly's gone because he's not on the team. But O'Reilly and that big giant dude who I thought was on Raw is Adam Cole's bodyguard. I thought he was already called up, so I thought O'Reilly's just a matter of time before he ends up at AEW.
Yeah, you know, again, NXT is in this state of flux. We have to be honest with that because we don't know the direction that Vince McMahon and Bruce Pritchard want to go to. But since we are going back and forth because we're going to talk about Florida Championship Wrestling, TW, let me ask you this because I want to say a statement here. This is just the professor being the most objective man in the IWC, YWC, because you know how I am. Because I don't shill for nobody. I don't shill for WWE. I don't shill for AEW. I don't shill for nothing. So I did like NXT. You know, I went to the takeovers in Brooklyn for, you know, like 4 years straight. I was having a ball with the presentation of NXT. But TW, I think NXT 2.0 reminded me that there's this one thing that WWE has to do. And they did it, you know, if you haven't watched the Peacock, if you haven't subscribed to the Peacock Reflectionized, they have something called the Ruthless Aggression Season 2. And one of the episodes they had was kind of like a futures episode, you know, stocking for the future TW. They were talking about the OVW people like the John Cena's, the Batista's, the Lesnar's, the Shelton Benjamin's, showing that core. Now, the one thing that I liked about NXT was that it was on the WWE Network. It was for a smaller, hardcore audience, but it still was a smaller audience. Let's just say it was like 15% of the main audience, you know, that main demographic. You kind of have a buzz for somebody, and it felt bigger when they made it, when they made the jump to the main stage, to the Raw or SmackDown. The problem with NXT 2.0 is that it's on the USA Network. The problem, even though it's still a smaller ratings, and I'm being real here, Reflectionizers, you know, they get like 500,000, whatever. It's still a small chunk. It's a small percentage. But seeing these guys and gals on the USA Network, TW, and then if I, you know, in let's say 6 months, you see them on Raw or SmackDown, you know, the Braun Breakers, the Von Wagners, the Raquel Gonzalez's, the Dakota Kai's, it doesn't feel bigger. And the reason I'm thinking about
it's
that, because, yeah, it's too lateral because look at it from 20 years ago, TW. Brock Lesnar did a dark match.
Just look at the Shield.
Yeah, the Shield, I guess 10 years ago. Right, you didn't know who they were. You had a buzz. You probably read the dirt sheets like, these guys are in FCW. These guys are in NXT. And they're going to make an appearance. But if I see these, you know, this is the problem of watching every WWE programming on USA Network. If you follow this, then a Braun Breaker, Rick Steiner's son, who has all the charisma in the world, all the untapped potential in the world, if he goes to Raw, shit, I don't care. Right. And then, you know, for someone, one of the mainstays like Johnny Gargano, who can be Daniel Bryan 2.0. I know you don't like the word 2.0, but I had to say it. He could be
I called him the next Daniel Bryan if they put him right, but they don't use him.
And he could go to SmackDown. Will it be a big deal? He's probably the last of them. Him and Ciampa are the last two big NXT stars to have some kind of pop. What say you, TW, about this? Because that's the difference. Because the OVW guys like Lesnar, Cena, Batista, you know, it was a little bit of a, you know, you heard the rumblings from the dirt sheets. You heard the rumblings from the Meltzer readers. But then when they got on the main stage on main television, they had to build that rep. They had to build that street cred, so to speak. Now,
which the internet community doesn't understand, that just because they like them doesn't mean everyone else knows who they are. That's why.
No, I know that, but it's going to be
sink or swim. But here's something. Mm-hmm. So, you know, in the last couple of weeks, a big deal has been Cody Rhodes throwing his belt into the audience and get thrown back at him, right?
Right.
In that match, there's about five dudes.
Mm-hmm.
NXT stars when NXT ruled the world. You had Neville, Andrade, I think the FTR were mm-hmm. they part of it?
Yeah.
And then
that was it.
Aleister Black. So yeah. There you go. There's four dudes right there. No, five dudes, because one whole team is NXT. And then you look at it, and AEW fans aren't going to appreciate this, but I would say the AEW fans are the ones who watched NXT, and when all their guys got just spread out and thinned out and jobbed out or whatever, that's what made them long for something like AEW, because it almost feels like AEW is where those NXT guys should graduate, because it's the next step up as far as traveling. And even though I feel like they're in Chicago every other week, but you know, like NXT used to be just Florida every week. That's it. Mm-hmm. And then when it started getting hot and they were traveling, and they sold out here in Royal Oak in like 5 minutes, not a big building, but it still sold out in 5 minutes to the point where I couldn't go. And then COVID hit and messed that all up. So NXT might be a casualty of COVID, right? Because mm-hmm. I would have thought it would have excelled, because it was already in a smaller venue. So them wrestling in front of a few people was old hat, you know, like it was weird watching Raw and SmackDown.
But TW, a lot of people say within the IWC, YWC, that AEW is being run in the vision the way NXT was supposed to expand itself. Right. So right. That's right. What it. Everything you right. Say, even not graduating, it's just the presentation.
Because yeah. If COVID doesn't happen, NXT might be the one that's making the way AWA is the alternative, because people did view it as something different. And that's why it was funny to me when it came out that Vince was going to be running it and everyone lost their shit. And then it turns out Vince was always running it. That's where you just like put that in your pipe and smoke it. Like he always had a hand in it, but it was always sold to you like it was Triple H's baby. Triple H had to fight. I know this personally. Mm-hmm. He had to fight to get Rhino there, because when they first started it, he kept telling Vince he wanted to sign. Remember how they brought back Shelton Benjamin and all those guys when they first did the brand split, because they needed more bodies on Raw and mm-hmm. SmackDown, because right. They thinned them out by putting, you know, when they, because remember they went away from it and then went back to it. Mm-hmm. So that's what he wanted to do with NXT. He wanted to bring in guys who people knew who they were, but also so when they started going on the road, someone could show them the way. And Triple H fought and fought and fought for Rhino until he finally got him. So I know for a fact that if Triple H was running it, Rhino would have been there already. But he literally had to get Vince McMahon, because I don't know if you know the story, but Vince was never bringing Rhino back again ever, because of something that happened in Anaheim during a WrestleMania. You know, whatever. That's for the dirt sheets. But anyway, the
politics.
And it was rough. It was right after the USC people destroyed the hotel room, and it went like viral before viral was a thing. And mm-hmm. they kept reporting them as WWE wrestlers, and Vince was like, "That's not us." And then something happened with them. Then everyone was right. Like, "It is." So, I'll tell you what. This is going to sound funny too. The way the scenery is on NXT 2.0, it's almost like they made it a Peacock show, like the colors and everything. It should mm-hmm. be on Peacock. But I think one thing that would fix it for me immediately, to the mm-hmm. point where I'd care a little bit more again, turn the lights off. I hate that it's so loud and vibrant. I liked it when it was dark and gritty and they wrestled in those, especially when they first came back with fans from COVID, where they were in the mask and the plexiglass and the fence, almost like that MCB Underground stuff. Like, I like that grittiness of it. Now, I don't know. It looks like preschool. I mean, I can't think of another word. Like, the color spectrum, it looks like preschool. Like, they're trying to attract little kids. But the funny thing is, it's the one with the more vulgar language and the more innuendo and all that kind of stuff. Because mm-hmm. I still feel like they're trying to cater to AEW fans, because they do all that stuff on there with the innuendo and the cussing and stuff that they, which they're starting to do it on Raw and SmackDown too. I watched Survivor Series. I watched Raw this past week where AJ was blind. I watched that. And,
okay.
But I'm a man without a show right now. And the more Adam Cole comes out with the Young Bucks, the further away he gets from me. But I found out today, right before we started recording, the Elite number 92 series edition of Adam Cole, not only are they still making it, it's coming out in February, they're making two. He's in his black tights and then the chase to match the other three guys' camouflage gear. Mm-hmm.
Well, one thing. Don't worry about Adam Cole, because when O'Reilly comes to AEW and you got Bobby Fish there in AEW, the undisputed elite
Gargano
will be there.
Gargano will be
okay. Gargano will be a great replacement for Roddy Strong. So that they could be a good
AEW. I thought they were the same person when I first started watching NXT.
Oh, see, that's the problem.
Legit.
If they all look,
they were the same guy.
If they all look the same.
Oh,
so
that's that guy.
But again, TW, it correlates with what we're going to do here with FCW from November 2009, because WWE's developmental system, to me, in its greatest heydays, was with Jim Cornette and OVW, because it was and Les Thatcher, Danny Davis. So, reflectionize. I want to say this first before we even talk about FCW, because I'm not going to try to clown on FCW. I understand the corporation TW always wants to put its hand in the cookie jar. But sometimes people like Jim Cornette, who love to develop young talent, let him do what he loves to do when he sees that young talent and development. And I keep going. They go back to the greatest OVW class of people when you got Cena, Batista, Lesnar, Randy Orton, Shelton Benjamin, TW. I mean, when you got a stock class of guys, and then Mickey James came from OVW, Beth Phoenix came from OVW. This was Jim Cornette, nurturing untapped potential. And the greatest advantage of this untapped potential is it was a localized market. And like you said, TW, NXT 1.0 was in a localized market in Florida. It was the same fans going into Full Sail, mostly week in and week out. So, it's like that. It's like those ECW fans going into the ECW arena. You grew up with them. It's an intimate setting between the fan and the wrestlers. But again, to me, the presentation needs to be localized, TW. Do you agree with that assessment? Because I don't see NXT 2.0. Again, I don't even see NXT 2.0 even lasting for one more season on USA Network before it moves suddenly to the
back
Peacock.
To Peacock.
Yeah, that's the way I see
would
it.
I would agree because
it protects the wrestlers from all the
but
think about
not,
it that
but
way.
But not only that, but if you're going to be in the same place every week, right?
Mm-hmm.
Why would people go there? They could just watch it on TV for free on USA Network, right? It's there's something about being there for sure. I think it's being in that college that it's probably free or at least cheap to the students or whatever.
No, this is at the PC. This is not Full Sail anymore. They're at the PC. They renovated it to have fans.
I thought it was still Full Sail because this dude just got his master's there. So anyways, I think your diehards are still going to go there, but you put it on the Peacock. It's almost like TV destroyed the indies, TV destroyed NXT. Even before they went to this 2.0, me and you, had some issues with them being a two-hour show because, so Dynamite, I'm not picking on them, but I'm going to give you an example. It's a two-hour show, and then there's Rampage, and both of them, CM Punk is on both of them all day, all night, with two differences. He wrestles on Rampage, but he TV commentates on Dynamite. Then they have his
before.
Match on
now
Dynamite,
they're trying to switch that now.
So they at least made it different. Like if you want to watch him wrestle, you got to watch Rampage. But if you want to hear him talk, you got to have him. Then he's just doing both on both. But when you have a 2-hour show and you have a stacked roster like AEW, and I still feel like I see the same six guys on it every time I turn it on, that's not good. And that's what I liked about NXT with 1 hour. Is there was weeks there was no Adam Cole. There were weeks there was no Gargano. And I was like, damn, those are my dudes. Luckily, there wasn't weeks where both of them weren't there. It would be one or the other. And then Ciampa got hurt. And Ciampa grew on me a lot, right? Like, I liked DIY. I didn't really like him when he first turned on Gargano. But they ended up having – I think they won Feud of the Year. They ended up having a pretty good run before Ciampa got hurt. And that led to Adam Cole and Gargano having their little run, which I'm glad Gargano won the belt first, because then when Adam Cole won it, it wasn't tainted like it was for Gargano.
I was there when Gargano won the belt, that takeover.
Nice. I am jealous. So so when it's only on for an hour, that does another thing. It makes that two-hour takeover that much better. Now takeovers are just another week, really. It's not even mm-hmm. but getting back to the NXT War Games, it's a pay-per-view on a Sunday night. I'm excited for that because I feel like this could be the time where they do something different. Like the look of it's going to be different. And then the mm-hmm. weekly show can be that freaking Peacock Network looking thing. But maybe War Games is darker because it's a pay-per-view. Or it's just going to look like another version of the TV show. And it should be 3 hours if it's on Sunday night, right? Instead of two, which could might be even more too much. I think it should go back to 1 hour, like this FCW show, and then 2 hours for the takeovers on a different night.
It should. I agree with it 100%.
And localize, like you said, and maybe even do this. Like, it's been in the news to these wrestling journalists on Facebook. WWE ticket sales are lagging, so they're offering 2-for-1s and 3-for-1s. I personally don't believe the 3-for-1s part. 2-for-1s I do, but I also think it's probably because of Black Friday, because I just bought 2 Red Wing tickets for next Tuesday's game because they were 2-for-1. And so mm-hmm. everyone was doing 2-for-1 this past whatever. So, but it doesn't jive with the fact that WrestleMania is going to be in Dallas and 100,000 people are going to be there and they're all going to buy tickets. So it doesn't make sense. Yeah, I can see people not going to house shows, but Raw, SmackDown, and pay-per-views are always going to draw at least a sellout, I would think. I
know, or 90% numbers, or 90% capacity.
So you take NXT and you make the weekly TV show every week in that performance center, and then TakeOver is going to be the thing that travels. Like, have it in Chicago, have it in New York, kind of like it did.
Mm-hmm. That's the problem.
You should do that, and then that way you can, it's almost like going back to square one. You got your grassroots following over there by the performance center, but then you'll see, okay, how much is the rest of the country taking to this? Let's try put them at the Hammerstein Ball, or let's put them in Chicago's small arena that AEW runs every 2 weeks. Let's put them, I'm just kidding. But
no, but that's, I mean, but slow.
If it grew to something bigger again, Professor, I'd be okay with it.
Yeah.
But I would want it to have nothing to do with Raw or SmackDown.
With the formula of being in the same place week in and week out, you know, I can even use the TNA Impact Wrestling because they were on it at Universal Studios week in, week out. Even if it wasn't live, 90% of their shows were from that, you know, Universal Studios. So you had maybe a localized fan base that went there religiously. But when they traveled, you know, does it play well in Dallas? Does it play well in Chicago? Does it play well in New York? And sometimes some of these wrestlers don't gravitate to the mainstream audience. And that's the thing that NXT...
Hello, NXT call-ups.
That's the problem. Well, it's booking, and then really there's no investment. And that's my fear with these new school guys. I don't have a fear with Gargano. Like I said, I think I'm comfortable with Gargano and Ciampa being the only guys left to get a pop for going to Raw and SmackDown, because to me, my attitude would be like, God damn, it's been too long. They deserve it. But right. then with someone like Bron Breakker or what's his name, Joey Gacy, I don't care.
Joe Gacy. I think Carmelo's destined to go there. You know, and the fear would be he'd be Ricochet 2.0, but he might go there and be, you know.
But Carmelo's a great example of okay, he's in SmackDown. Okay. So what? I want to be invested, but that's the problem. I think sometimes you got to scale back with your untapped potential talent. Don't put them on the main USA Network. No matter what Reflection Nights have against Vince McMahon and Bruce Prichard, NXT got paid millions of dollars from USA Network to be put on there. And you and I are in the same boat. You're going to pay me money to put my product there? I'm taking your money, and I'm putting my product there. But the problem is your guys and gals who are untapped potential are not ready for prime time. You know, this is not Saturday Night Live, not ready for prime time players.
Which is why it worked grabbing indie guys that knew what they were doing.
Right, indie guy with a name and a rep. That's the thing.
Who's Big Swole?
Big Swole is Cedric Alexander's wife.
What's her name?
I don't know her real name, but it's just she's
that's her name on AEW is Big Swole?
Yeah, Big Swole.
Is she that muscular girl?
Mm-hmm. Muscular African-American.
She was on NXT? She was on NXT before?
Maybe she did the Mae Young Classic. I can't confirm on that.
There's a couple. I know Jade, whatever.
Cargill.
She's skinnier and taller, right?
Mm-hmm.
And
with the blonde hair.
Velvet or some shit.
Yes, small in stature.
But that one, she's more like jazz, but like hot. not dude build.
I don't know about hot, but you know, jazz face.
Her face. I mean, she's got more of a
jazz body.
Feminine,
yes.
Muscular body. Like jazz, yes. Was huge.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I think I know what it is. She wear red a lot.
No.
Maybe, I don't know. I'm a Googler.
Yeah, Google her while we're doing this. But now, Reflectionized, since my diatribe, I'm trying to give you a little bit of a difference of what, you know, the good old days of developmental is with, like, Jim Cornette and OVW. Again, what, you don't believe, you don't agree?
That's not who I thought she was.
Okay. Jesus, reality hit hard, Reflectionized. But anyway, the corporate structure of the WWE, being a publicly traded company, wanted to get its hands in the cookie jar and mess with Jimmy Cornette and OVW. And then they turned to Steve Kern, who was still in Florida and had his own school, his own factory, Reflectionized. And then the Florida Championship Wrestling, you know, bubble started being created there. This was at least two or three years before the Triple H envisioned NXT. This was 1 year before the Vince McMahon's Kevin Dunn ridiculous NXT or Wrestling Got Talent, whatever you want to say on the Sci-Fi Network TW. So I don't, you know, I'm trying to give a good logistical history here. But anyway, we're going to focus on FCW TW. Now, you know, again, this is a great example of a localized television. This is probably on the Sunshine Network in Florida, TW. But there are names here, TW, that we all can recognize. There's people here we've recognized. We've seen on the main roster. They've had a major impact here. We're not going to do match-by-match Reflectionized because some of the matches, I fast-forward them. I didn't care about it. But there's names here that you saw here. And this is the attitude, TW, I would have had, like, I'm interested, you know, in a localized setting. I'm interested. Maybe let's see where it goes.
It felt like a local show.
Yeah, it was a local ECW show, a local TNA show, something like that. It was...
No. Local, like, indies. Like, you don't really know who these people are, but you're like, hey, let's check them out. Like, it's funny because we know who they are in hindsight, but there's a lot of people here with different names. Like, mm-hmm. Similar, but when they get called up, their name is tweaked.
Well, you know what?
Justin Angel.
Yes. Justin Angel is the current FCW heavyweight champion. If you don't know who Justin Angel is, well, in NXT 1.0, well, or 0.5, or Vince McMahon's Wrestlers Got Talent, he was Justin Gabriel from South Africa. Or now, if you follow the indie train and you follow him in Ring of Honor, he is PJ Black. He's a skydiving jumper. TW, so, you know, from the jungles of Africa, but...
Isn't he New Japan, too?
He might have did New Japan. He did Lucha Underground. He did a lot of other stuff. So, you know, he's been around the world, TW, five times over. But Justin Angel, as you said, or Justin Gabriel, we'll use Justin Gabriel for the NXT purposes or the WWE purposes, is the current FCW heavyweight champion. Now, I look at that, TW, that says to me that the office has big plans for Justin Gabriel, a.k.a. Justin Angel. If you're going to put the FCW title on someone like Justin Angel or Justin Gabriel, TW, you expect him to do big things on Raw and SmackDown. But the funny thing is, in hindsight, the biggest thing he did was auditioning for NXT. And he joined Nexus. He joined the first crop of the NXT people, which was himself, Wade Barrett, Daniel Bryan, Bryan Danielson, Ryback, Skip Sheffield, Michael Tarver. So he has
Slater,
a legacy.
Man.
Of course he's Slater, but here is Heath Miller. So what say you about...
Wasn't McGillicuddy?
No, that was the second crop.
Class?
Yes, the second class. So what say you, TW? I mean, before that, we know in hindsight where he went into the Nexus thing, but when you have the belt on you, that's a different thing. I mean... Plans must have changed.
It's a test to see, you know, what would he bring people to the building, really? I would assume, or Buzz or whatever. Like, when I used to wrestle local shows, how I would know how I was doing, because you don't, you know, when you wrestle on the indie show, it's the same amount of people every show, so you don't really know whether or not they're coming for you, or they might be coming back for you. But my friends would always tell me, like, yeah, at intermission, they would tell me the match that everybody was talking about at the restroom or the snack bar or whatever. So it was probably a feeler to see, like, what I want to know is, because early on, I'm like, is that Wade Barrett doing commentary? Like, why is he doing commentary back then? And it's funny because 2009 did not feel like it's that long ago, but it's 12 years. And literally from right now, 12 years ago, in 2 weeks or 3 weeks. And you're just like, it's insane, because the main event match is half, almost everyone in that match was part of Nexus, right? There was no Daniel Bryan, but you had Skip Sheffield, and he was new. Like, it was like one of his first matches there. And you're like, 2009, isn't that right when the stuff happened? But that stuff happened, what, 2010 or 11?
Give or take. Oh, with the Nexus stuff? Yeah, yeah. So it was 2010.
Yeah, 2010, so it's a year away. But Wade Barrett, and then they put a little heat with them because he's sitting there to do commentary for that main event match. Wade Barrett's like, what are you doing out here? This is mine. And Byron Sexton is there. And it's like, it's cool to see all the people that did make it. And then you see other people, you're like, okay, well, what happened to this guy? Like, I'm skipping around, I know. But, like, Jimmy Uso's there with some dude who looks like he – I'm like, is that Jay Uso with just short hair? But it wasn't. It was – and the dude had, like, a white guy name, but he was straight up Samoan.
Donnie Marlowe.
Yeah, Donnie Marlowe. That doesn't sound like a redheaded white dude that's pale. I don't know what does. But
That's from the suburb. That's the suburbs of Samoa. See, that's why he's got the Donnie Marlowe
name. Next Friday. Yes. He's the cousin.
Mm-hmm. The Cucamonga Samoa part. But it is a good thing. I mean, you see these people, but TW, again, we're going to go back and forth really religiously here, Reflection Nights, because there's a lot of questions here, because you can ask yourself, TW, who was a success? And one of the names that pop out here is actually the first match. I don't know how young he was here. He must have been in his 30s, but, you know.
He looked like he was damn near 40 there.
Alberto Banderas, which you and I know as Alberto Del Rio. Now here.
Or El Patron.
Or El Patron. Yes, that is true, TW. So, you know, you got all the names.
Keep Alberto. Like, the weakest part of all that is Alberto. And he keeps it for every one of them.
Well, probably that was his name in Mexico too, Alberto Banderas. So that was Banderas was not his name in
Mexico. He wore a mask. Actually, UFC or not UFC, but MMA, he wore a mask. Yes. But
you see the maturation, as we say, of Alberto Banderas, and then this is a great example of something different, because like we talked about with Justin Gabriel being the FCW champion, and then, you know, we're kind of like questioning the direction of that guy, and I guess, but somebody paid attention to Alberto El Patron, a.k.a. Alberto Del Rio, a.k.a. Alberto Banderas. Of course, you know, you're trying to make fun of Antonio Banderas and then Alberto. You know, he was really, he's Mexican, but he's a white meat babyface here, and it doesn't work.
Tito.
But
he's Tito.
He's Tito. That is a great comparison. He's SCW's Tito Santana here, and then in about a year or two, he becomes the Mexican Ted DiBiase. So what say you, TW, about the maturation of Albert? I mean, if he debuted on Raw or SmackDown as Alberto Banderas.
He's a perfect example of what you said 20 minutes ago. I had no idea who he was when he showed up on Raw. And then I looked into, or SmackDown, whatever it was. And I looked into him, and I was like, he's kind of a big deal. So I thought it was one of those things where they signed him, and he went right there, right?
Right.
I had no idea he was FCP or SCW. And so he was the first shock to see him. I wasn't shocked to see Wade Barrett. Shocked that he was commentating, but I wasn't shocked to see him. Wasn't shocked to see PJ Black. I was shocked that Alberto Del Rio came out in the first match and as almost an unknown. It was it was his second match, I think. Mm-hmm. He was working Trent Beretta because the week before he beat
the other guy. Yeah,
the other guy.
Kaelin Croft.
Laura Croft.
Laura Croft or the Dude Masters, whatever that team name was supposed to be from FCW. But this is the example, like you're saying, what I'm trying to say, Reflection Ice, is the less you see them visibly on TV, the more interested you can be, or you can alter the character.
Like John Cena. John Cena, when he came out, nobody knew who the hell he was. He got in Kurt Angle's face and did the Ruthless Aggression deal. He was immediately one of my favorites because I pop for cheap heat, and when you come out wearing the city's sports team's colors, I notice. So he wrestled in Detroit with the red and white. He was in Boston with the green and white. He was in New York with the New York Knicks colors.
Blue and orange, yeah.
Yeah, blue and orange. And so I pop for that. And it might be cheap heat, but he looked like $1 million on top of it. You know, when he wrestled, it was a little choppy or whatever. But, I mean, you know, you got to start somewhere. So you're right. Like, so, but there is also something to say for when Adam Cole came out and beat Seth Rollins, I was pretty happy because Adam Cole is my boy. NXT's my baby. So when he beat Seth Rollins at Survivor Series or whatever, wherever that was, Monday Night Raw, whatever it was, that's good. That's good because you're it's like picking a sports team. NXT is my Red Wings. Raw is your Knicks, right? And then my Red Wings came to your house and beat you in your house. So there's something to be said if they can build it up. But right now, what you're saying, Bron Breakker's not big enough to feel that way if he beat somebody on SmackDown. And he'd probably just beat another guy who 2 weeks ago was on NXT 2.0. So, yeah, it's a different animal now. So,
yeah,
Alberto Del Rio shocked me. I knew those other two guys were developmental because he was only 22 years old there, Trent Beretta, which makes him 34 now, which is – that was surprising to me that he was already 34.
He's 22 there in 2009? Yeah. Wow.
He called himself the 22-year-old prodigy.
Oh, okay. I didn't pay attention to that. See, that's what I didn't pay attention to. That I when I saw Alberto Banderas,
right after
I was
that,
like,
I fell asleep. No, I fell asleep during AJ Lee.
Oh, we'll talk about that in a second. But
who did she wrestle? Because I thought that was Tiffany, the one that was with Drew. They got the drunk driving and got fired, and then she ended up in TNA.
Well, the name that she faced was
Courtney Taylor.
Courtney Taylor. So
I think it was Tiffany.
I can't keep up with all the people that I can't, you know, the professor. You know, the professor's log of the 2010s is a little bit murky right now, reflectionized, but I will have to fix it and update it. But, you know, the professor's library from the 80s, the 70s, the 60s, and the 90s is still good at early 2000s. But I want to retouch on Alberto Banderas because what you said was perfect. The FCW's Tito Santana. And I guess we have to ask that question, TW. If they kept Alberto Banderas as the WWE's next 2010s Tito Santana, would have been a major flop? Would he have been featured endeavored in 6 months? What say you, TW? And then we'll move on.
If they kept what? The name Banderas?
If they kept the image and the character as maybe the, you know, the 2010s as the Tito Santana.
Done. As a matter of fact, wasn't his debut against Cena in one of them open challenges and he beat him for the belt? He won the U.S. title from Cena in, like, his first time coming out there.
No, that was his second time coming out.
It was his second.
Yeah. The first time, it was the vignettes of him being rich and having the money, and then Ricardo Rodriguez. And that was a good pairing. And they weren't even together in FCW.
Yeah, you know, you said he was the DiBiase, but he was also JBL. So probably more so JBL because that Mexican gimmick stuff is also Texas gimmick stuff. Like DiBiase didn't have the freaking stretch limo that JFK got popped in. You know, he had a Rolls Royce. You know what I mean? Like,
but
he was,
you know what I mean?
Rich.
Yeah, you know what I mean. Just the comparison.
Obviously, JBL was a DiBiase too. That we all considered that. And now, you know, Grimes, Cameron Grimes is like rags to riches DiBiase. Not you know, like.
But it proves wrestling is cyclical. Gimmicks work, and if you give it to the right guy or gal, it can become $1 million and make Vince a lot of money. And
Courtney Taylor does not come up in any search that mentions wrestling, FCW, or WWE. So I'm guessing she didn't stick around long.
No, she had a different name when she went to the Indies. That's what it is. So I guess she wasn't
that
important.
Name doesn't come up at all.
Oh, okay. But
Championship Wrestling, is that what that was called?
Mm-hmm. Florida Championship. So speaking of Courtney Taylor, she fought another up-and-coming starlet, up-and-coming diva, Reflectionites. It is AJ Lee, you know, the spunky young lady from New Jersey, you know, from the Professor's Bombay area of New Jersey, TW. And, of course, we know in hindsight what she did on the main stage. We would call it a successful career in the WWE. She mixed it up with Dolph. She had programs with Dolph Ziggler, Big E, John Cena. And then, of course, she was a multiple-time Divas champion. And, you know, she fought against Paige and stuff like that, TW. So AJ Lee, you know, when you look at the character, the spunky character, we could see, you and I can see what Vince McMahon sees. A spunky young lady who can offer a variation to what the Divas is. You know, some of them are TNA, some of them are for the looks in the show. But then you have someone like AJ Lee with the look of someone who just wants to wrestle. And, you know, Vince McMahon was trying to, like, give and take with, you know, the puppies, the puppy people, and, of course, the wrestling people. You know, like, you know, the Professor did love the TNA, you know, women's wrestling with Gail Kim and Awesome Kong and stuff like that. And this is 2009 TW. So Vince McMahon was paying attention to TNA and what they were doing with the women's wrestling. But Vince McMahon said, I have to at least get some of the people, the puppies, you know, the puppy power, and then kind of mixture it in with some females that can go, like Beth Phoenix, Victoria, Mickie James, and stuff like that. What say you about, did you see the potential in AJ Lee, or you were just shocked that she just became that successful?
I am shocked that she became that successful. She did have that cute, aw shucks look to her, but God, I'm going to pick on my own favorite guy. She's like even smaller version of Adam Cole to the women than Adam Cole is to the... No, I'm serious. Like, she should have been broken in half, right?
Oh, my God.
So there's a couple girls on NXT that remind me of AJ Lee.
Wait, hold on. Reflection, I saw. Don't hate me, but if you want to hit at me, Adam Cole's got to look up to AJ Lee. That's how small he is. Go ahead, TW. I'm sorry. It just came into the brain.
That girl, the American Ninja Warrior girl, Casey Castanado or whatever.
Casey Cantanero, Ricochet's ex-girlfriend.
She is tiny like AJ Lee, but she's 10 times the athlete. Like, she, you know, and I think she even has more charisma, but it's almost forced, whereas AJ Lee didn't do much of nothing but wink and nod, but it's because she dressed like Raven. You know what I mean? That's what I think got her over, is the whole punk rock. She was Avril Lavigne is what she was. And then there's another girl there now who's feuding with Mandy Rose that's tiny like that. And it's like, the reality is we've all been to high school. That little girl right there, the hot girl that everybody wants to put it to, is the one that gets beat up by the girl with a little meat on her bones just for being hot. You know, right. But also because she can, because she's tiny. So yeah, it did. Like, she made Paige look big. And when Paige came out, didn't Paige beat her?
She beat her up a couple of weeks during Raw, and then AJ Lee got her payoff win against Paige when she left the WWE.
Paige won the belt from her on her first night while still NXT women's.
No. Paige won the belt her first night. Damn, I forget the history of that one. It was somebody else.
Because she was still NXT champion when she won the Divas title.
Is it maybe you're right. Maybe
it was AJ.
Maybe you're right. It's AJ. You know, I'm trying to remember the fighting with my family, that the spot where she debuted, and maybe it was AJ Lee, because Tia Trinidad, aka Selena Vega, played her part in the movie. So
another tiny one.
Yeah, another tiny one. So it could have been AJ Lee. You're right. Go ahead, TW.
But no, I mean, she's so small that you just like, and by the way, that Courtney Taylor, she went on to become a many different names. She was Daisy and then Wesley Holiday. She ended up becoming an ECW ring interviewer. That's what she ended up becoming. She didn't even wrestle after so long.
Oh, the WWECW. That's why I don't remember
WWECW,
her that
and
well.
Then she got replaced by Alicia Young or whatever.
Whatever. And,
but she posted for Playboy, Girls of Hooter, 2008.
Oh, cool. At least
she owed ass.
Nassatol. That's what it is. Nassatol. But, you know, let's put a ribbon on AJ Lee, you know, what she is now. She is one of the, I guess, the pillars of WOW, Women of Wrestling, along with herself and Tessa Blanchard, when that becomes a thing in 2022 Reflectionite. So if you want to keep up with AJ Lee, she's an executive producer for Women of Wrestling. So she's going to, you know, she's going to be scouting talent, TW. So she's got the fire. I think what made her, I think what makes her successful, TW, in hindsight, in comparison to Casey Catanero, as you said, that she's more, you know, Casey's more athletic because she's the American Ninja Warrior. But I think AJ has the passion. I think you could see she was a fan when she began.
Right.
You know, and exactly. She cried when she met her heroes like Lita and Trish Stratus, you know, and she persevered. She probably made a hot dog, you know, she didn't make that money, you know, the hot dog and a handshake like you did, you know, grinding and hustling her way into the WWE. So I think I think she has more passion than Casey. And of course, in hindsight too, you know, the relationship she has with her husband, her current husband, CM Punk. I know you don't like CM Punk. I think they're a match made in heaven because they both have the passion for wrestling. Even though if you don't like CM Punk, I respect that, TW. But they both have a passion
for professional wrestling.
Yeah, that. Well, maybe
CM Punk
maybe
has to look up to AJ Lee.
Right? Yeah, I knew you were going to say that. But you gotta give the devil its due. They both have a passion for wrestling, and I think I don't see it with Casey. So that's just me. If you agree or disagree, but I
no,
think,
no, 100%. That's what's missing with her for sure. But I'm saying size. Look, she has everything AJ Lee has, and then some because she's a better athlete. Even though they tried to say AJ Lee was one of the best athletes in wrestling when she was there, they say that about someone every fucking 3 weeks. But. Yeah, Casey didn't grow up wanting to do this, and it shows. John Cena did. Bill Goldberg didn't. You can see the difference, right? They're both green as grass when they start. One got better. One is still the same. And it's because one of them, it's a paycheck. One of them, it's a passion. So I absolutely agree with that. And this young girl that's with Mandy Rose, she looks like she probably grew up a fan, you know? Wrestling, right now, girls the age of... in Castanella, she's so caught up in that Ninja Warriors. I guarantee you, she was a gymnastics girl. She probably had no time to watch wrestling. Whereas some of these other, Mickey James, even depending on where you grow up. But my point is, NWO Attitude Era, it wasn't just young boys watching wrestling anymore. It was college dorms. It was 22-year-olds, 21-year-olds getting together, having parties on Monday night, and girls would come to that, too. So there's a lot of girls from that time frame who grew up that maybe want to be wrestlers now who are 17, 18, 19 in high school, and now
Bailey.
They're 30.
Bailey,
and,
Sasha Banks. Great
yeah,
example.
And now
that.
They're 30, and they busted their ass for – you know, it's my, those are two girls right there who – I don't know if I've ever told you this. You kind of look like them a little bit, but Zima Ion, whatever. I don't know what his. He's got a sweet wrestling figure coming out too. Half his face is painted, but like Los Muertos. But anyways, that guy watching him on that Ring of Honor documentary where he meets Jim Cornette and he ends up making it to Impact. Remember, and he got hurt really, really bad there. But when I watch stories, he's one of them. Bailey and Sasha are either on one of those. Lead up to WrestleMania documentaries or whatever.
Okay.
No. It's a short before they were stars is what it was. They did one with Seth. They did one with Bailey. They did one with Sasha Banks. That's what makes me invest in them. I like stuff like that. And I haven't watched a lot of that stuff on the network since it went to Peacock, admittedly. I think if I started watching that stuff, I can't stand Seth Rollins. I don't know if it's the beard. I thought I hated him when he had the blonde patch of hair and he liked Cruella DeVille. But I think him, the person, very likable. Very likable. Him.
Colby Lopez is likable. Seth Rollins is a
right.
dick.
And mine and Travis's buddy, Travis's tag team partner, trained him. And I've actually seen Little Dan. You know who Little Dan is because you're an ECW fan. He was Danny Daniels, the referee. He was Devin Daniels when we wrestled with him. But he has Steel City Wrestling. It's in Chicago, and Seth went to his school, living in Iowa. He went to Danny's school, but I want to like him for Danny, right? My, you know, our buddy trained a guy who went on to beat Brock Lesnar in the opening match of a WrestleMania to win the title and be called the Beast Slayer. But
right.
But something about his character. Now, then you have Sami Zayn, who I don't like at all as a human being or as a wrestling character, and he's only gotten worse, if you ask me. But anyways, I don't know how I got off on that tangent, but
when
you watch stuff like this, I think this would help NXT or FCW, whatever. This is, I can't believe I'm bringing this up right away. The very first thing on this show is when Alberto comes out, they do the old school WWE superstars picture in picture where they cut promos on their way to the ring. And I was like, that's what's missing now. Like, to give people their color, their personality, and all that. And now they rely too much on in-ring interactions or backstage funny stuff or whatever.
Just or video or video montages.
I like video montages, like vignettes.
No, but some of them don't look authentic.
Were you excited for Razor Ramon when he finally debuted because you loved them damn vignettes that he did leading up to it? That was good stuff. No.
Vignettes and video montages are very different, especially from back in the days to now. These video montages look too forced into and no development. Because I don't know what is going on here. Because sometimes
I did that Monday Night Raw I watched. That Monday Night Raw I watched. They did a video montage of Bobby Lashley, and it was not lost on me that almost every person taking a bump was Keith Lee, John Morrison. name a guy that got released. The Fiend. I think he bumped The Fiend. Name a guy that got released. Braun Strowman. Body slamming Big Show back ECW stuff. It was like every guy he pummeled was either released or in AEW now. And then, by the way, tat tip to my old buddy who would he would know who I was if we saw him in person, but he just big times me ever since he big time. But Edge, when he spoke up for Miz, I had nothing. I knew it was going to come up. I love how he addressed it. You're on someone's mind for someone to mention your name to get a cheap pop. And I thought, that's exactly what that was. And it was a shot at a guy who couldn't be a nicer dude in real life. Think I told you my story about Survivor Series 05? Nobody talked to The Miz. Nobody. It was like he was a Miz fit, for real. Like, no one. And I talked to him because my ex-wife was a huge Road Rules fan. And that dude in 2005 told me, he's not doing Road Rules and Real World anymore because he wants to focus on wrestling and give it his all. That was 16 years ago. There's never been a time where he was not in the WWE since. So the guys that take shots at him like that, it's low-hanging fruit, man. It's absolutely – the funniest thing about that guy is he'll be the first guy to tell you he ain't tough, that he's absolutely certain you would kick his ass if you got in a fight. And that's cool. Like, he just an absolute gem of a human being, and I love that Edge did that in a promo where they're healing on each other. It was – he still defended – I just thought it was very, very well done. I saw someone ask the question on the Hustle page, and you took a tie. You said it was a push, and it was because they're apples and oranges. But
yeah.
But for me personally – I love that he defended him like that.
I'm not in the mood to like compare. You know what I mean?
Right. It's apples and oranges.
Yeah, I don't compare promos. I can't say which one is better because it doesn't matter. I judge a promo by where the direction of the two people are going with it.
Right.
Then that promo means something. And again, MJF and CM Punk, that promo was good. But again, you know,
I'll bet you when I finally watch it, it won't be as good as everyone says it is to me. It'll be typical. Like, I watched that Eddie Kingston and Punk promo. I felt like a lot of it was legit heat. But my buddy Dennis in L.A. was like, dude, are you giving Eddie Kingston lines? Because he's literally saying the shit that you say about him to him. And I guess when MJF, buddy texts me, he goes, dude, MJF just said to him, I don't know how you can be straight edge and look like a meth addict. I say that to my buddy all the time. Literally word for word, I say to him, I'm like, he's straight edge, but he looks like a meth addict. You tell me how that's possible. So
he's shadowing your Twitter or he's shadowing your Facebook. You never know.
Or text, because it's just in text that I'm saying this stuff.
That too.
He's part of Zuckerberg.
Yes, he is.
So let's get into some FCW here, TW, and a segment that I kind of found funny that was on WWECW. So, you know, Vince McMahon was amused by this segment. The Abraham Washington Show. I know you don't like it. I just wanted to point it out. But it was funny because Abraham Washington here is the FCW commissioner or general manager. And the lady is Katrina from Lucha Underground, if you didn't know who she was.
I did not.
Or Carly Perez. But everybody knows her as Katrina from Lucha Underground, and she's now in MLW. So I don't know the other lady, but it didn't matter to me. But what was missing from Abraham Washington
is Oksana.
Well, that's Oksana? Okay.
Dude, smoking hot as a blonde, horrible looking as a dark-haired girl. What a difference. And when what she came out, Wade Barrett goes, oh, my gosh, she looks like Pam Anderson. I'm like, she does, like, spot on, look like Pam Anderson. And then talked like she never learned to speak words in her life until that day. It was terrible. Not even English. It was just not even made sense.
Well, Oksana, wherever she was trying to be Maurice, and it just didn't work for me. That was the problem of one.
Wasn't that before Maurice, though?
No, Maurice was there a little bit in that bubble. She was already on the main roster. Maybe she wasn't there. Again, it just shows you how bad I am with my library. My library of the 2010s is really off. But the one thing that was off with Oksana is she wanted to be Maurice or another Russian girl, or she was trying to be Lana before Lana was even there. That's the problem. Number two, the problem with the Abraham Washington Show was I was waiting for Tony Atlas That's the only thing that I loved about the Abraham Washington Show on ECW or WWECW was Tony Atlas's gut-wrenching laughter that made it watchable for me. But
I was hoping that when I saw Abraham come on, I'm like, okay, this is going to be good, and it's going to show me why they put his ass on TV every week, as bad as that was. It was just as bad. The way he interacted with, what's her name, Carmelita, whatever you called her, the way he interacted
Katrina.
With her, getting jealous of him, talking about the other one, then his spot that he did with Gabriel, which must be why Justin Angel was Justin Angel, that was terrible, both of them, not just...
Right.
Isaiah, but what did he end up getting fired for? Didn't he say something like an OJ joke or something?
And he could have been. He probably said something on, you know, Sci-Fi. Again, when you're on Sci-Fi and you say something and it's a publicly traded company, Reflectionites, you're gonna have to pay the consequences. Whether you or I don't like that, TW, you know, he's trying to be funny, but then you know that PC is getting, you know, that was the inklings of PC, and now we're already into, you know, a lot of people call it cancel culture right now today, but it's just overly PC to the hundredth umpteenth degree. So that's just what I look at it. So you're probably right, but Abraham Washington, this was one example of FCW of the transition to something on the bigger platform. The only change in variation was he got a set on in the ring. And he was added a co-star or a co-host with Tony Atlas. But nothing changed with Abraham Washington. He was the only thing, like Alberto Banderas, he changed his character. Justin Angel turned into Justin Gabriel. Skip Sheffield turned into Ryback. Abraham Washington was Abraham Washington. Nothing changed with him. That is, to me, ultimately surprising. And probably, you could give me examples of, no, Professor, there's other wrestlers that probably went from indies or the, you know, these little localized things and didn't change in the main roster, but I can't think off the top of my head, TW. So I mean, Abraham, I looked at Abraham Washington like nothing changed, really, right? Nothing changed. What say you, TW, about that? Surprising to me.
I'm stunned that he got put on. He's bad. It's like that. You picked the perfect episode to just everything he did not work, from how he was hitting on Oksana. To how that Eli Cottonwood guy came out, which I kind of remember him on Raw or SmackDown, but not for long.
Mm-hmm.
And Oksana just, he didn't know how to lead her as an interviewer. She was dead in the water. That guy come out and said weird shit, and Washington just made fun of it. But then he said a somebody, he goes, this is the only cheetah I wouldn't mind eating me. And he goes, yeah, I said it. I said it. That's the only thing I pop for. But then he just ignored the girl who was on his arm. So I had no idea who she was or why she was there. I assume it was his girl. And that's why she was getting mad at him. So he didn't say
something. Or administrative assistant or executive assistant.
And then that whole segment with that Gabriel guy, who I'm assuming wrestled under a mask as Mr. FCW. And it could have been bad writing, or there was good writing, and he just botched it when he did his version of it, because he's telling the guy you shouldn't be here.
I am surprised that even though this is not live, or this was tape delay, this was like tape, like, they didn't edit this to make it look good. This looked like, and the fans didn't care about this segment. If you really watched the reflection, go ahead.
No reaction from the crowd at all, and Prosperity, Michigan. I thought I said Prosperity is bringing my Subway to my kids. I'm like, someone named your kid Prosperity? So anyways, the crowd just didn't care, but the whole thing made no sense because he just, in the middle of talking to Eli Cottonwood, just turned and then said, hey, is that who I think it is? I told you not to come here, but I bought a ticket, you know, the oldest thing in the book. And he says, I'll tell you what, if Mr. FCW beats my good man Frankenstein here, Eli Cottonwood, I'll reinstate you. He didn't even ask him to do it. It was he's supposed to be mad at him for being there, and then says,
and
hey,
nobody beats him,
and nobody gave a crap. And he's a guy who never made it to Raw that I know of. And then that 8-man match had some dude that came out with like Billy Gunn boots on.
Wait a minute. Let me give it the names out here.
Okay. For,
this was called the Super 8 number one contenders match. To become the number one contender to Justin Gabriel, aka Justin Angel, for the FCW Heavyweight Championship. The combatants were Brett DiBiase, TW, Kurt Hawkins.
First one out, Brett DiBiase.
Dylan Klein.
That guy.
Heath Slater, aka Heath Miller. Joe Henning, aka Michael McGillicuddy. Michael Tarver. Skip Sheffield and Tyler Rex. These are the eight, I guess, pillars of or the young faces, the young prospects, if you will, of FCW, who supposedly, the former TW, these eight guys, they are supposed to take over Raw and SmackDown for the next 10 years. And from this Super 8, the only one that stayed is nobody. Nobody was there. The longest was Kurt Hawkins before he got released.
Kurt Hawkins, who's wrestling like Matt or Jeff Hardy here, the denim jeans with the white hole belt.
Mm-hmm.
And he looked like him and Heath Slater at some points I got mixed up. He looked like a 3-man band guy or 1-man band. Weird stuff. I was waiting for Zack Ryder to come out because they signed together. They legit started out together and signed with WWE at the same time. So when that Klein guy came out, I thought it was Zack, and then it wasn't. I'm like, who the hell is that guy? So how long after 2009 did the Edgeheads debut?
I thought the Edgeheads debuted in 2008.
Okay, so this is post-Edgeheads.
Yes.
Okay, that makes sense.
And TW, again, the Super 8, these are eight supposedly untapped potential competitors, untapped potential contenders that – hopefully, again, like I said, would take over Raw and SmackDown and, you know, help, you know, the train of WWE go along for the next 10 years. Nobody's left, TW. Even someone like Joe Henning, who
Wade.
Has... Well,
he's in the exact same spot.
But we're not talking about... We're talking about people in the ring. Wade Barrett, you know, whatever. I guess he has debilitating injuries.
His
body is really brittle.
Themselves. Bernardo Del Rio did it to himself because they even brought his ass back. Trent, he's in AEW, isn't he?
Yes, he's in AEW.
Best Friends or whatever their dumb tag team's called. PJ Black was Ring of Honor. So at least some of them are still around.
Right. But I'm not talking about, going and finding other work. I'm talking about they're supposed to be the guys, the main guys to be in WWE, the headline pay-per-views.
Ryback did it to himself. Michael Tarver had no business ever getting called out. We can be honest now. He never had it. He had a look. He looked like Michael Spinks. That's about it. And That's it. He's
what if we flip Michael Tarver and Abraham Washington? It was the Michael Tarver show, and he was the commissioner, and Abraham Washington was is in Nexus. Would it change your mind?
That's rough. Michael Tarver has no charisma. Like, I can't even imagine someone giving him a microphone, because when he ever did talk, it was terrible.
I'm just asking, because you just had the faith. See, this now, reflection, this is a reason to watch this on YouTube. Look at TW's face when I asked him that simple question, because he's really thinking hard about this one. Either he was thinking hard, or I punished him for
Washington
thinking about this.
Did start out as a wrestler like Byron Saxton, right? Like, yeah. Byron Saxton literally was, like, he had a...
He was it. Byron Saxton was it.
Bobby Lashley, half John Cena, like... But he just must not have wrestled very well, because they
he was in the second class of NXT, the one after Wade Barrett won. The second class. He was
wrestling. Why is he FCW commentating?
I have no idea.
I don't understand about Wade Barrett either. They must have both been hurt. But Byron's a good commentator. Like, he's the fall guy. Like, the jokes are always against him. Like, when they brought that pizza out. No, the pizza was the pay-per-view. As I say, maybe I did watch Raw twice. But,
you probably did.
I want some pizza, and I'm like, it's right next to you. Just eat it. But I like Byron Saxton a lot. But I seen, because I think he wore the shorts like Billy Gunn and Bobby Lashley before Lashley went to pants, and Cena before he went to the Eminem look. But he had a good look, but he's polished. Like Coach is a good guy for the role he did. And then when he turned him heel, it kind of ruined it, because he's heel, right? Like, but
Byron cannot do a heel. His face.
No, but and that's what almost ruins him, is he's the slappy, but he's polished. Like, when I just seen he's not on Fox Sports, but Coach, I think he's either on NFL Network or he's on.
He used to be on ESPN, but now he has his own podcast. He's doing his own thing.
No, but
he's
saw him anchor. He either covered soccer or he covered golf or I saw him covering something recently.
He's not under contract. I know what you're talking about, but he's not under contract. Yeah, he's freelancing, but he's got his own thing. But Coach is doing his own thing. So TW, the winner of this Super 8 was Curt Hawkins. So, you know, Edgehead did win, but again, Curt Hawkins, who, when I see him in Impact as Brian Myers, it is night and day. I think Curt Hawkins is a name that kills him, so that's one thing for me. But
you like him better as Brian Myers?
You know the funny thing? Here's a good example of the localized, centralized thinking that the professor has. I saw, you know, Brian Myers, a.k.a. Curt Hawkins, in this little localized promotion called WrestlePro a couple of years ago, before he came back to WWE with himself and Zack Ryder as that tag team. WrestlePro is in Jersey, and it's in the tri-state area, TW. And he had a great heelish gimmick. He was carrying like a cane and stuff like that.
Yep,
he was being a heel and a dick. Then he comes back to WWE, and then this is the problem, because of my localized thinking. I'm like, damn, they ruined him. They ruined what I saw
he
from that.
He still had that damn cane. He went on that losing streak, remember?
Yeah, but the image, the presentation just didn't mesh with me, because I saw him in that localized thinking, and then I progressed that. That was my fault. I couldn't variate from what he was doing in a localized setting to what he was supposed to do in the mainstream. I understood why he had to lose 100 times in a row. But
and then when it ended with him winning the tag belts. That was a good little program.
But I guess the problem, TW, let's try to put a bow with this, because it correlates with anything. You've probably seen some people in the Detroit area. I know sometimes you always go back and forth with your man Scott DeMore. I think you always said you go to, like, Canada before COVID. Well, you went to Canada.
Gretchen and Trudeau fucking ruined it.
Yeah, before, whatever, I'm not going into politics, but you did go out to Canada and you spent some time watching the young guys and gals, and you see some, but if you saw those young, untapped potential guys and gals, and then you see them on Impact, or you see them on WWE, or see them on AEW, and their presentation is so off that you say, damn, they don't even know what they're doing, they're missing the money,
it's
so
like
to speak.
When you see a job guy on Saturday Morning Superstars and his gear that he would wear at an indie show where he's champion, and the initials on the boots and the tights don't match the name they gave him when he's already in the ring,
Right.
You know, Chimelo Bella Cruz, and his tights have like RKO on them or something, which actually could be you because mm-hmm. it would just be fan tights. But like a guy that pops in my head who you just talked about, but they did use them pretty good in Impact, and they also used them pretty good in the that breakout tournament or the Cruiserweight Classic. Tyson Dukes. He's an old acquaintance of mine. I always mm-hmm. pull for him. He literally got offered a contract, went out and wrestled the dark match, blew his knee out, and when he got to the back step, he said, you know, we can't still give you that contract, right? So he's out for a year or so. Then he had border problems. Then he's in that Cruiserweight Classic. You know who got his spot?
Who?
Drew Gulak.
Oh, wow.
Tyson was about to get re-signed, and that's when he had visa problems, and they went with Drew Gulak. But Tyson was about to get signed. But he's someone that, when I see him on TV, he wasn't the same as he is when I see him at Border City, right? Mm-hmm. So, but me and him both got kicked out of Joe Louis Arena for the Monday Night Raw, the first one after September 11th. We were both there. Boy. He got kicked out. I got there, and they wouldn't even let me in. And then finally, Edge was going to get me a friends and family pass, but I would have had to come back like hours later because they tightened up security. You couldn't be in the back without one of those lanyard things with the play card. And I asked Dukes, I go, dude, I'll drive you home because he lives in Canada. He's like, no, I'm getting in there, man. I'm getting in there. And to this day, I've never asked him if he ever made it in. But mm-hmm. but it was cool because Edge came outside. It was March, too, so it was cold. He came outside and talked to me for about a half hour, explaining to me, you know, hey, it's different now. You can't get back here without this thing. He's like, but I can get you a friend. You like, you know how there's that section where they almost pander to it on TV because they know everybody. It's people's friends and family section. So mm-hmm. I could have done that. I'm like, nah. I go, I came to see you and Larry. I go, I got to see you guys. I'm good. I go, have a good show. I watch on TV. So I didn't want to go back downtown 3-4 hours mm-hmm. later because I got there early in the day.
Right.
Off, obviously hoping that they'd use me. And that's what Dukes was trying to do, trying to get used as like a Undertaker Druid or something like that. But it's a different mm-hmm. day in 2002. That was March of 2002.
I get you. But again, to put a bow in this, everybody looks different in a localized setting and then in the main setting. And sometimes we cannot differentiate or maybe we can't separate because we feel as fans, maybe we're the hardcore fans that we are Reflectionites, that they're not being used right. It's missed opportunities. You could make billions if you do it the way we see it right. At the localized setting. And sometimes that just does not work. And with that being said, Reflectionites, we close on this episodic episode of FCW from November 29th, 2009, 12 years ago, TW. I mean, I have gray hairs in my
November
head.
November 29th?
Yeah, November 29th, 2009.
So it's literally 12 years to the day almost.
Almost.
November 9th. It was 09. That's right. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, so TW, give out those socials so we can get out of here.
The Pro Wrestling Coalition Network. You can find them at the PWC Network at podbean.com. Our good man, Big Vito, is Big Vito Brand at wixsite.com. That's WIXSITE. Or patreon.com/ the Big Vito Brand. Our man, Big Ray, at Big Ray Hernandez on the Twitter. Our man, the P1JB. JB, we had contact with him today. There's hope that he's going to return in the future. You can find him on Twitter at the P1JB. Please tweet him and tell him to come back to the show. We'll even mm-hmm. do a show for him just so he comes back. Our show is obviously at PW Reflection. And then you have me. I have at Tommy Winter 19. That's where I school people when they don't know what they're talking about on politics. And then at the Tommy Wonder, my Snapchat is at #1. I don't know if there's no at, but #1. Facebook.com/Tommy Wonder. And then you have Dumb Dumb Duel and an Idiot on YouTube. And to talk about Kirk Mulpey, he was an awesome sport about everything. I spent most of the night talking him into doing it because he was going to back out. Then he said he wasn't. It was for charity while he was there. He ended up bartending. My buddy Matt, who's one of the Dum Dums, he went for the cheap heat and wore an Edmonton Oilers hoodie. And I pointed it out to Maltby, and he goes, hey, man, it's near to my heart. I go, it's called pandering. And he laughed or whatever. We were supposed to do shots of Pink Whitney, which is a type of liquor that was, I think, made by Ray Whitney, who was an NHL retired player, and then picked up by Amsterdam Liquor. We were going to do that, but he didn't want, like, video or pictures of him drinking out there. You know, it's a family business. So we did the one-ship challenge 2.0. Him and Stacy handled it like champs. Stacy had some hiccups right away, but you're supposed to go about 5 minutes without drinking, and I thank you for putting me over. But not only was I the first to drink, I toasted. I said, hey, I voluntarily lose, and I drank my drink.
That was CGI. That was CGI reflection. Yeah, She's lying.
So I drank my drink, then I stole Stacy's drink, and then I drank more of her drink by pouring it in mine, and then I grabbed Matt's milk, which milk is disgusting, and I started chugging milk like Kurt Angle because my mouth was so bad. It was so on fire, and I don't know why I do these things, but the next one we're doing is soon, and I've got a new girl because you gave me the week off for Thanksgiving. I went on multiple dates with her, and now we're just progressing nicely, so she's meeting my friends at one of the videos we're going to do. I didn't tell her that part yet. And we're eating as many Taco Bell tacos as we can in 5 minutes, which is not going to hurt my mouth as far as heat, but it's going to hurt someone's toilet later. So
if you put the spicy sauce on the taco.
Well, we could, but like I already told them, like, I'm not getting lettuce and tomato on mine. It's going to have cheese, sour cream, and hamburger. I'll throw some hot sauce on there. I don't care. My daughter, Emily, got me putting Red Hot on there. And one day I asked her, I go, damn, Emily, I go, you don't mind this? She's like, Dad, it's not that bad. And I go, how much you put on there? She's like, one or two drops. She goes, how much you put on there? I go, about eight. She goes, Dad, you can't put eight on there. I'm like, now you tell me. So, but it's fun. It's just your taste buds ain't the same for a week. Then you don't know if you got COVID or just aftermath of eating hot foods.
Gotcha. All right. And for the reflection, as you can follow me on my Twitter at PWSOPROF. That's PWSOPROF. And of course, you can follow us on the PWSO YouTube networks, where hopefully this edition of the PWR podcast will be available on our YouTube streams. And of course, follow my brothers in arms, the man with the documents, Billy Ray Valentine, Mr. Infinite Fringe himself at Obi-Wan, you know me, and of course, the king of the reactions, 8-Track Brown at 8-Track Dastardly. Next week, TW, I don't know what we're going to do. Maybe episodic, maybe spotlights, maybe robberies, can't do Santa with muscles just yet, but, you know, I know you're looking forward to watching Santa with muscles, but we're going to do the... No, that's Hogan. That's Hogan. that's another couple of weeks from in the month of December. So we're gonna, you know, sprinkle that in. Maybe another. So maybe two more weeks.
You talked about his handle at T and Couponer, but Josh Floberg, he's the guy we need to get on JB and get him on here. He sent the awesome gif of Andre the Giant dancing, and he's always sending us ideas on stuff to do and everything. So Josh, get JB back on the show, even if it's for one night only. Get him back.
We will do that.
Yeah.
Of course, shout outs to, you know, our reflection IT and Couponer, Josh Floberg, and of course, all the reflection
Michael Davis. They're heavy on the Twitters.
You know who you are, and we love y'all to death. And for that, I'm the professor. That's Mr. Wonderful, Mr. Indian of the Dum Dum Duos, TW Tommy Strong, aka the Tommy One, is saying good night, and we'll see you next time here at the PWR podcast. Are you dabbing?
JB. I meant to do Boomerang Eddie Murphy, but it wouldn't fit in the screen, so I had to dance.
Oh, okay.
JB.
See you next time, Reflectionites.